I'm going to order here because I have an announcement to make about my Birds of a Feather dinner tonight, if that's what we're calling this, Beers of a Feather, at Otto's Pub. I called to get a reservation, and apparently they don't like it when 20 people show up unannounced. So the best time I could get was 6:30. For those of you who are running the 5K, I think it's probably more important you come to Otto's with me. I'm just saying, exercise is highly overrated, as you can tell. And actually, it's about exactly 5K from here to Otto's. So just drive it. Just drive it. It's easier. It's faster. You use a car. So my pitch session is that you should come to Otto's at 6:30. I didn't make a reservation for 20 people. They will actually, Otto's is being gracious, they're going to allow us to sit down even if there are only about 10 of us. The other thing they said, though, is because it's 20 people, they're going to get one check. So if you are coming to Otto's, bring cash, because ETS does not have enough money to foot the bill. So that's all I had to say, so thank you very much. Who's the MC for this? Yeah, you cannot use your meal card that Alan gave you this morning for that.
I think Cole's talking about the 5L run, liters instead of kilometers. So anyway, it's my pleasure to introduce session 3, which is on engaging students through game-like elements and external media. You know that myself and my colleague Bart here and a couple other people in the Educational Gaming Commons have been looking at games, virtual worlds, and simulations for some time now. But a question that often comes up is, can't you take some of the things that you do in educational gaming and simulations and so on and apply them in non-gaming situations in the classroom and so on? And the answer, of course, is yes. And some people are doing that. So I'm happy to be here with the following panelists today. Dirk Mateer is here, and he's going to show you some things that he's done. If you've ever seen any of his YouTube videos, they're pretty awesome. I particularly like the one where you have the kid go up to the front of the class and spray himself with the axe spray. I mean, that's just a classic. So for those of you who've never seen that, you've got to check that out. Bart Pursel from IST is here. Bart's does a lot of stuff in his classes that are game-like or games themselves. Sarma Pisupati, it's been my pleasure to know him for a couple of years. We collaborated on a project. It's been a little bit longer than I care to admit. But he had... he had a very interesting project where he was doing what was a light bulb simulation, where you had a light bulb and you had boxes over top of it that had different types of insulation, and you had to measure them. Well, these kids were coming in pickup trucks to pick these things up and haul them out to do everything. So we ended up doing a simulation of that in Flash that was really cool, where they could do the same thing. And Sarm has gone on from there and done all sorts of things. So, and then finally we have Loanne Snavely from the libraries, who she's going to talk about some things the libraries are going to do. So without further ado, I'm going to open it up. And although I've introduced all of you, if you want to go around and talk about your research interests and some of the things you're doing recently that you think are particularly applicable to this group and gaming and game-like elements.
Sure. Thanks, Brett. My name is Bart Pursel. I'm from the College of Information Sciences and Technology. I also work with Brett and some colleagues down at Education Technology Services. I'm not going to try and promote the EGC, the Educational Gaming Commons, although I'll plug that from here and there. I'll try and focus on IST and what I've done in the classroom with games. I've used games a couple different ways. One way is just kind of a means to an end. So I do a lot of introductory to Photoshop work. I teach IST freshmen as well as IST seniors. In my freshman courses, to kind of get them engaged with Photoshop, I basically do a game design user interface assignment. So I talk a little bit about user interface concepts, HCI, things like that. And then I give them a brief introduction to Photoshop. And we go out and either grab game screenshots from the web, and they lay their own interface on top of that based on the concepts of good user interface design. Some people have even went so far of making their own game user interfaces and their own kind of game concepts. And there's also a design document that kind of accompanies this. So a lot of the way I use games in that sense isn't really focused on the game itself. It's just kind of a way to get some people engaged, get them excited, and a lot of people in IST happen to be gamers. So it's a little gimmicky, but it helps get them excited right out of the gate. I also am starting to, with the help of Digital Commons, put together a machinima assignment. What this is kind of using video games in a digital storytelling fashion. So I'm trying that this year in a couple of weeks, actually, using the game lab that's going to be opening here shortly. where students are going to have to use game software and capture video and create some sort of story using, you know, the hero's journey or some kind of storytelling mechanism, but use games as the medium to do that. And again, the reason I'm doing this is I want them to learn, you know, video editing, how to use various video editing software tools. So again, means to an end here. It's not really focused on the game itself. It's just using gaming technology as a hook to bring these students in. I've also used Second Life in the past. I've used Second Life as kind of an introduction to 3D modeling, an introduction to scripting. It's a very lightweight environment that kids can do things pretty fast in. And some kids really take to do some amazing things in that environment. That's all pretty much at the freshman level. Once I get to the senior level, I start to use game-like elements to really try and engage kind of the capstone course, IST 440W. And what I basically do is borrow just the simplest of ideas, a high score list, kind of a competitive idea. So I have them kind of pitching different ideas, pitching different Web 2.0 ideas as if they were a company and they were looking for venture capital funding. And I make them kind of get up in front of the class and give what we call the elevator speech. And everybody else in the class then votes. They allocate a certain amount of venture capital money, fictional money, of course, to these students. And it adds a whole level of competition that really kind of drives motivation, really drives engagement. It's amazing when you just add a tiny little element of competition into a course, how much students really kind of get involved and get into it. We kind of tried this buzzword bingo thing here. Did anybody try the buzzword bingo game here? A couple of people. Did anybody win yet? So we have a winner. We don't have any prizes, unfortunately. You get bragging rights. And that, it's amazing how far that goes with students. There are no prizes in the classes for the winners, things like that. But just the idea that, you know, you won some event over your peers is enough to really drive some motivation and drive additional engagement that sometimes you don't really see. And a lot of times when we think about this, we think about video games, right? But I'm working on things like board games. You know, these things have been around forever. Good games are good games. The good game mechanics kind of carry from board games to playground games to video games. So we're working on a board game that deals with social networking. Kind of your idea is you have to traverse this board and make decisions about who you're networking with. And your score is based on how, you know, how your network impacts your professional life, your personal life, your family life, all these different people that you interact with on things like Facebook and MySpace and these different things. And again, that has nothing to do with computers. It's mostly just whiteboards and moving stickies across whiteboards and rolling dice and things like that. Another way to engage students. And just kind of one other thing that I'm not sure if people know about yet, nothing that we're involved in at this point, but an interesting initiative that's going on in New York right now. They're rolling out something called the New School in New York City this fall. It's for 6th graders through 12th graders. It's an entirely game-based curriculum for 6 years. So everything in every class is all entirely game-driven. And we're really curious, you know, how open they're going to be, number one, if they're going to be able to share all these curricular materials they're developing for the New School, and if we can kind of take these and leverage these here at Penn State and other universities. And also kind of assessment. We kind of heard a little bit about assessment in the last panel. Assessing games can be pretty tricky. It's very difficult, depending on what kind of games you're using, on how to assess these things. Second Life in particular, you know, you have to go in and you have to open objects and look at code and know some of these deep menu structures to figure out, you know, are these kids actually doing this legitimately, or are they kind of doing workarounds or things along those lines?
I'm Dirk Mateer, and I'm a lecturer here in economics, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk about this. I don't really have a game, per se, for you to think about. I'm more on the animation side. And I come at this from the traditional faculty perspective, where I'm trying to think about how to engage a classroom, although they put me in 100 Thomas, so I have 726 students at a time. So I'm trying to think about ways to really reach out and sort of capture and motivate students and build up interest. And so right from the get-go, I wanted to try to reach out to students on platforms that I thought that they would be comfortable with. And so that meant when I first got here 9 years ago, I started playing music before class, which was okay. But eventually I figured out that I could get students to actually create animations of songs where the lyrics and pictures would be timed in together as part of a project in the course. And they would use Flash or PowerPoint or whatever other software authoring tool they wanted to do these things. And the best of these became the things I showed right before my class got started on that day's topic. More recently, I've been working with Digital Commons. I'll put it the other way. Actually, Digital Commons came to me because I had so many students involved in a video making project in the class that they were overwhelming them. So they wanted to know what was going to happen before the crunch hit. And so I just sent my students out and I said, look, work in groups of four and create a 4-minute video about a couple of topics on economics. Go out, be creative. You could make a song. You could act it out. You could do whatever. You do the all the editing, all the work. You upload it to YouTube. And then I'll share the very best of these ideas with the rest of the class. I play them in class. And, of course, students can share these results with their family, with their friends, and you can kind of see which of these really reach out and touch other students in the course. And that, to me, was a far more powerful way of engaging students in a really big classroom environment than simply assigning an invisible term paper that nobody else actually read. They got comfortable with the technology at the same time that they got to share and interact and learn more of the economics, which was my underlying goal. So those are the two main areas that I'm interested in. And as this, I guess, panel goes along, if anyone wants to see an example of one of those, I'd be happy to share that with you.
Hi, I'm Loanne Snavely. I'm in Library Learning Services. And I got started with this sort of through the back door, years ago. An instructor in an English 15 class came to me and said, none of my students have been to the library. I asked all of my students, what she said was, I asked all of my students how many had been to the library. This was towards the end of the semester when she was teaching. And she said that three of them raised their hands, and two of them were State College high school students who had been to the library when they were in high school, and one of them has said they had gone into the library, it had been so big and so scary, and they didn't see any books, and they were afraid to ask, and they ran out. And I thought, okay, we need to do something here about all of the things you were talking about engaging students, of bringing them in, reaching out to them, because it is a really big building. A lot of our students come from central Pennsylvania. They come from high schools that have small libraries, and these days many of them have no libraries. I mean, students more and more are coming with less of a concept of the library. So we started the open house, which was supposed to be kind of a party in the library, just to get students in, to get them around, to get them the big picture of the library. Tours are deadly. We were trying to stay away from that, but we wanted to really get them in, get a picture of what a library was like, so that they would know there was a special collections, a whole library just for maps or for business or whatever, to give them that big concept. Not to try to teach them this is a database that you would use for this, but give them a big picture. So Elisa is in the crowd here, and Elisa's very first day here at Penn State, she started in on our very first open house. And we started just trying to make it fun and to get students around, and we did a lot of different things. We, as you all know, have subject libraries, and the folks in the subject libraries all participated so that students would get around to different areas. And we tried to get them to go to the library that related to either their major. So if they were an engineering major, that they would visit the engineering library. They would know where it was. They would meet some people there. They would find some friendly faces. If they were in business, social sciences, whatever, they would get to their library. If they didn't have a major yet, we said, choose something that's interesting. And then we tried to get them to other places as well. So getting them around, getting them engaged, enjoying it. And so people started using games to get them involved. Some of them were educational and some of them were just fun. We also had lots of prizes. And I'm going to show you just a few photos. They're actually more than a couple of photos, but I'm going to try and just whip through them really quickly to show you some of the things that have happened over the years. Where we are here, sorry. So we did advertise games. This was from several years ago, but we talked about doing the open house, and we games were part of it, and prizes were also part of it, and we got really wonderful prizes, iPods, more recently laptops. We did sort of a, a GIS sort of a mapping. We tried to do a little bit of a spatial mapping thing, both on campus where the libraries were and within Petit and Paterno. So there was a sort of a certificate that students would take with them, go to different areas. And now I'm just going to show you a bunch of different kinds of things. This was something where we had maps and students put little dots on to show where they were from. So we had one of the whole world, and then we got down to Pennsylvania, and then we got some areas of Pennsylvania. So trying to do things that engage them. Here is a DDR. This one was a basketball. I can't remember what this one was for. A hoop toss. Games of chance. This was going fishing, some kind of a fishing game. Here was a little ball toss of some kind. One year there was a sort of a hopscotch, and a group of kids came into the library, and boy, they loved it. That was a lot of fun. Down the News and Microforms Library, they did a Penn State alum elected U.S. president in a landslide, and kids got their pictures taken in the let's see. This one I liked. This was croquet in the arts and humanities. There were often, I'm trying to go through these quickly, but there are often some sort of educational elements to them. So this was croquet in the arts and humanities library. And there's some research that's showing that nowadays students do not really understand what the humanities are. They don't necessarily know that it's religion and classics and music and so forth. So these little croquet things, if you can see, are all labeled. This first one is literature, and there's music, philosophy, classics, and so forth. The business library had a golfing game. This was a shot on something. We have the spikes and the Nittany Lion come by sometimes. There are games of chances that have to do with the prizes. Student clubs. This was juggling. There was dancing. There's DDR again. There's R2-D2 dressed up as a pirate. One year was the pirates. Rolling dice. In our evaluations, the students do a quick evaluation to enroll for the prizes, as they enroll for the prizes, and we ask them what they like the most. The gaming elements were often cited, so frequently, the gaming elements. So, and just like rolling dice for prizes was one of the things that was named again and again as something that they enjoyed doing. So here's a little game about putting books in order to understand call numbers. It's amazing how a few decimal points can be confusing. This was a matching game. These are all over the years, so we've been doing this. Lisa just told me that she thought we had had 40,000, over 30,000 students over the years in come through the open house. And so it's fun. Here's one that the social sciences did. Helen's in the audience here, but it's called Piracy in the Social Sciences, and it's one of those find the word kinds of games that have all to do with, again, the social sciences. So advertising, you can't really read, crime, law, politics. So all of those kinds of things to help students understand maybe what was in the social sciences. This was a pirate naming game. Be a pirate, more dice rolling, more DDR. There's the Nittany Lion often will come. So we often invite the mascots and different people. We do have the evaluations where students can sign up for prizes. The digital commons and gaming have been part of it. This isn't a very good photo. We had some other ones. But last year and this year, I think, they were out there. This was dancing. This was another student group that did dancing out in front of the library. One year we had Graham Spanier come and do magic tricks, and I put this in because Emily, wave your hand, Emily. Emily Rimland is working with a group of people this fall for our open house on an alternate reality game that's going to be part, run kind of parallel with the open house, not right during the time, since we have thousands of students in and we try and get them around to all of the branch libraries as well as around in Petit and Paterno. Things are pretty crazy. but we want to have about a week for students to do this alternate reality game. And the premise, this is a big secret and hasn't been approved, so don't spread it, don't tweet it all over the place, is that Graham Spanier did a magic trick that went awry. I won't tell you the whole thing, but finding the clues to get it, to reverse that little magic trick is going to be the theme of the alternate reality game. So if you like to do puzzles or have ideas about that, you can contact me or Emily and we'll try and incorporate it. We're going to have three or four quests to get to an end result. And I think that we have several Dell laptop computers to give away as prizes this year, and I think we might be using one or so of them. We haven't made a total decision about that. But anyway, so just to give you a quick look at some of the ways that we've used games in the libraries. Most of those are kind of old-fashioned games. They're not electronic. There'll be a little bit more of an electronic theme in the alternate reality game that we have coming up, but lots and lots of people within the libraries participate in preparing for this event and doing it, and it's one of the things that we think of as, I don't know, when a kid learns to read, there are all kinds of pre-reading skills that they have before they learn to read, so they have to learn the letters and all of those kinds of things. I think of this as sort of a pre-information literacy thing, because we find that students are really not coming to us with a big idea of scholarly information of what there is to offer. And so we really try and get them in there and get them engaged and give them a big idea about what a library is all about while they're having a lot of fun. And students tend not to think, oh, I love libraries. There are a few, but not very many. Most of them have kind of a negative attitude towards the library, a lot of apprehension sometimes. And so helping them to understand the big picture of the library and about what kinds of resources, so that they know their maps and atlases, they know that there are special collections and all kinds of materials in the library, so that as they go down the road and they're doing assignments and hopefully as they're creating videos and other kinds of things as well as papers, they'll use scholarly resources within their research. So that's some of the ways. Those are some of the ways that we have been using gaming in the library to try and engage students. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Sarma Pisupati, and I'm a faculty member in Energy and Mineral Engineering. In how many of you know where Energy and Mineral Engineering is, in which college? Oh, that's good. Annie is from our college, she knows, at least. Oh, that's good. Okay, that's good. A librarian knows. That's good. It's a College of Earth and Mineral Sciences. Although we are an engineering department, we are in Earth and Mineral Sciences. And I have been involved in this, teaching a lot of students since 2000. You know, as one of our panel members earlier said, you know, I'm not white, but I'm tenured. I lost a lot of hair teaching, but it's so much fun. I mean, teaching actually in class, particularly if students are engaged and if they are interested in. One-way traffic is easy. We can put up slides, you know, but so that's when it started, because I was actually tasked to increase, actually our department wanted to reach out to students and teach about energy and environment. This was in 2000, before 9/11. We saw that it is coming and we decided to reach out to students. Not our majors. Our majors are captive audience. They are in like Guantanamo Bay. You know, they are captured. You know, they cannot go anywhere else. But I'm talking about other students on campus, business students, you know, art students, who are really not interested in science and engineering, how to attract them to our disciplines and teach about energy and environment. So that was not a simple task. We developed two courses. I know I was instrumental with a lot of other faculty members and a lot of other staff from ETS, from E-Education, proudly, E-Education Institute. Credit is not mine, but right now, we reach out 6,000 students, and I teach personally 3,000 students. every year. It is so fun. And how did I get into that? I teach 11 sections. I have 9 graduate students, again, to supervise, and I have research projects. But I don't want to give up teaching. That's what my head of the department says all the time. It's not me asking you, you want to teach. Yeah, it's a disease. You know, when you want to teach, you know, you want to teach. It's an addiction. So that's the way it is. And let me share some of the things that I do in class. Again, it is very difficult. It is very difficult to keep the attention span of the students. All right? You know, you all know that. 10 minutes, gone. The brain goes somewhere else. And it's very difficult. So we have to change the monotony in classroom. We started in classroom in 2000. 2004, we started putting courses on online. And I started this course, particularly EGE 102, which is basically energy conservation at home, all right? And this course we started in 2000, with 60 students. With all the activities in class, let me tell you, it's not my greatness. It's the activities in class and basically the kinds of things that we do in class. The enrollment increased right now to about 2,800 students. And I'm the only instructor. So it's you know, it's very, very good, actually, to do that. And I'm proud of that. If you go to any lesson, actually, there are a lot of things that we can do in these things. In every lesson, we have, this is, let's say, we go into lessons, and we go into, this is our lesson, all right? This is the first, you know, every lesson. You know, there are a lot of these caricatures there, you know, personalizing, actually. This was started by Dave Stong, actually the first one in ETS. He took that picture and started with Brett in 2000, probably. And then Mark DeLuca, actually in ETS, has done a wonderful job. Let me give credit to some of the folks. And then actually when this came about, like when I started teaching 2,000 students, we talked about plagiarism. If I give a problem, most of the students are not interested in this material. They hate science. That's the reason they are in business, they are in arts. You know, why would they do it? They say, well, did you do that, buddy? Take that, copy it, submit. How can I check 2,000? Numerical problems, or something like that. So we devised this wonderful thing, active thing, basically. Like, we have, with E-Education Institute, I have to give credit to Marty there. You know, he's our database expert there. And I dreamt about this. If we have a database, and through Flash, if we can feed individual numbers, individual assignments to every student, no way they can copy. No way. So at the beginning of the semester, we created a database with all the students after drop ad period ends, and then the students get individual assignments. And when they go and do assignment, like assignments will be, I don't call them assignments. I call them activities, home activities. Let me show you the home activities also here. If we go into here, residential activity one, I give them instructions.
Okay, now is the time to do our home activity one. This is like homework one. This is a fun activity that you will be doing on computers. The way you can locate it is...
I show them how to do it there, okay? This is the actual activity. When they go in here, all right, their goal is, let me tell you, 98% of our Penn State students did not know by what unit electricity is measured. Electrical bill comes to their house. 98% of the college students did not know that it is kilowatt hour. Isn't that amazing? So the first exercise is, because they didn't pay the bills, their parents did. All right? Now here we give the instructions. Again, these activities are developed by ETS in the beginning, and then we have modified a lot of times with E-Education Institute. You know, this is not my property. It's basically, you know, we have developed this together, and this is basically they're going into a house. Each will get different numbers. Let me tell you this. All right, they go into this one bedroom, turn on the light, and when they click on this air conditioner, it shows how many watts it is. So they estimate, this watts, 1,380 there, is for me. When you log in, you will see a different number. When somebody else logs in, somebody else sees a different number. Computer knows. And then when they turn theirs in, computer will check the numbers and give me an indication that it is okay or across. Of course, we go and check all these activities later on. But these things, like, again, on a computer, every number will be different. Every student will get different numbers. They move on like this. They put all their numbers in here, all right? And they go, whatever that number happens to be, and they calculate certain things. And then they go and write a few things here. This is the fingerprint again. Anybody can write, but you know, a paragraph will tell us actually what their thinking is, what their process is actually. So they write, identify specific ways in which you can reduce energy, and so on and so forth. So they can write, I don't know all right, so that's what it is, right? We go forward. We're almost done, right? So this, I mean, they write everything. They answer, they write whatever they needed to, and then they answer. And this is like IRS return. We want to check again the values. So here is an opportunity for them to check. If they have to edit the numbers, they can, and then they submitting the data. All right, a lot of times they come back and say, Dr. P, of course, let me tell you one thing. My all 2,000 students have my cell phone number. I give them up. They can call me at night. All right, if they wanted to, until 11 o'clock. After that, it goes into a separate room. All right, so they can call me, and because, hey, it's like my own kid. If my own kid goes, she is going to the school, actually, my own. No. They need some help. No, I'm sure we all do that. When proposals are due, I know I do that. They go in on the last day, last hour, to my research office. How many of you do 1 week in advance all the proposals and send them? No. No, I take polls. No, our habits are like that. We cannot blame students. You be early. You know, do everything nicely. Yeah. Do you do that? No. It's like teaching is easy. So I give them credit. Okay. As long as you do meet the deadline, fine. That's what I do. When my boss asks something, I do it, you know, when it is needed. So that's the way it is. We cannot have double standards. So that's what I believe in. So they can always go back. They always say, well, I submitted. They actually, all my students call me by first name. Fine. They're not going to take my doctorate away. Just by calling my first name. So they have the freedom. I always call them, hey bud, how are you doing? And they call me bud. That's fine. Okay, I developed this first day. So they call me or they sometimes say, hey, I sent this submitted. This something happened and it didn't go through probably. No. No. It is like, oh, I just got your email. No, you just saw the email. You just didn't get the email. I sent that email 2 days ago. Right? This is the active part. So we provided this link here so that they can go and actually if they submit it properly, they would see this. Because I put blank characters, you don't see. Look at this. They can check the answers. Now they can go and party in downtown. That the assignment is submitted. So this is coming from the database. I have 6 of these activities. Let me tell you, they build it first, they analyze, they calculate the energy consumption. Second activity or homework is we give them 12-month utility bills. custom name with your user ID there, and they analyze the bills and look for the trends. The third activity would be even little more. They do an experiment that Brett talked about in the boxes, and if we have more insulation, what it would be like. I mean, I can show you all these things, but it's going to take time, you know? And we all get bored. It's end of the day, you know? We're all here just to spend a day, you know, happily, not looking at all these wonderful things. But, you know, we have several of these activity. Let me show you, appliances. This is one activity that I always love. Now they're going and buying. I said, go on shopping spree. I'm giving you $2,000, you have to buy an oven for your family with your honey. You go shopping with your honey. You will do that in 5 years, 4 years, 10 years, we don't know. But you're going to do that. And okay, honey, let's go and buy this washer, or let's buy this dishwasher or a refrigerator with all these things, wonderful things. So you do that. So I said, do that and practice that. So they go and actually choose to, they go to a virtual store. Believe it or not, virtual store here. And these are instructions. Of course, fine print is always fine, and it's lengthy. All the key important, you know, key things will be in the fine print. We all know that. So they go in here, and these are the, when people are building houses, we all do, contractor gives certain things. So these are the things that the contractor is giving. This is the price. This is the energy consumption. If you can beat the contractor price and save more money energy over a year, you get more points. All right, so they have to go and, you know, look through the, and go, okay, this is the energy consumption, I pay $700 up front, you know, over lifetime, this is the cost, and they calculate all these things, and they come back and actually enter these things. Now they're going shopping. Isn't that cool? You know, they can select, they can click on this energy guide and see what energy consumption is. If they're not happy, they can move on to the next refrigerator, next refrigerator. Next refrigerator, wow, this is stainless steel. Oh yeah, my honey likes this. You know, it's great. All right, oh yeah, this is really cool, double doors, you know? Honey's always like double doors, you know? Now, this is even better. More energy efficient, bottom freezer. So they can select anything, actually, any of these things, and they can say, okay, I select this one. They have to select two models. Okay, this is, oh yeah, this is the second one I like. So they have three now, contractor model, this model, and this model. Now they go back and do some calculations and figure out which one in the long run is cheaper and then come back again. These are the activities. Let me tell you one thing. I mean, the purpose is not to teach a class here. The purpose is using these activities, we're teaching them. There is no other homework assignments. They do this and the computer checks whether they are doing it right or wrong. It gives me a hint. Otherwise, explanations, etc., we need them. We need them in grade. We're not, it's not like totally computerized, SAT. Even SAT nowadays, we have this manual thing now. So we need to, you know, we need to examine. So we will examine everything, but computer helps us check the calculations. So these are all wonderful things that, you know, there are a bunch of these things, and I can go on, you know, water heaters, and they do a lot, you know, then you know, the clothes washer, clothes dryer, and all these things. Of course, this is one of the things, all right? And then at the end, one of the activities, they actually build a house. They build a house, you know, this is appliances, this is lighting, they design lighting. At home, you know, at home, which bulbs to use, you know, how much lighting, how many lumens really, and so on and so forth, and insulation and energy conservation. And this is the experiment that we were talking about, simulated wall. You know, where they're evaluating four or five different materials, actually, insulation materials, and they go to the actually virtual store here. This is cool. This is what Brett was involved in. Nittany Valley, you know, like Home Depot. You go in and you select this. It's exactly the way we read labels. They read these labels and figure out cost per, you know, square foot and calculate how much heat loss and how much they save money if they go for better insulation. Boom. Right? Like this, they do six activities. All right? And And they learn, at the end, they learn about energy conservation at home. That is the goal, all right? Let me tell you, the way I use all these things, these are not it. As our panelists say, our goal is here to use these things to get the actual science into their. A lot of times when students come, they go, when I say energy equal to, you know, force time acceleration or whatever, you know, if I use, are you teaching physics in this class? You know what I say? My friend, I hate physics like you. I hate chemistry like you. I hate mathematics like you. I just want to learn about energy. And I go on and talk about these things. And we do a lot of puzzles in class. And let me tell you, the way they do, they practice these materials, again, is by gaming also, kind of. If you go in here, and I, with $60 software, I can create the study mate. I know most of you are familiar with these things. If not, it's a worthwhile software, study mate software. We can create this. This is how they practice. Two players or one player. Roommates can sit together and try to do this. Which of the following conversions is least efficient? They can score. They can do these as many times as they want. It's a way to prepare them for the exam. I'm not going to look at their grades, although I can, and they don't know that. But I don't really worry about them. I want them to practice 1,000 times if required, because there are literally hundreds of questions there on each chapter. It makes them, you know, prepare for the exam. They come in and they take the exam. So using different kinds of things, we do these, you know, we teach the material. It's all through gaming, basically. Let me tell you, even in the content, actually online content, I didn't even open that part. If we look at, there are several, for example, let's go to lighting here. Let me show you here. Online lesson overview. Am I taking too much time, Brett? I think so. I know. Sit. Tell me frankly that you are going.
Show one more thing.
Okay. Show one more thing. Sure? Okay. All right. I can go to the next page here. How much lighting is needed? And I include some movies in here too. You know, how much light is required?
Now we're going to examine how much lighting do we need. Answer depends on what kind.
Boy, that's a quality movie, isn't it? Lumens, types of lighting. You know, I have a good one here actually that I wanted to show, but you know, I mean there are a lot of things. Actually, this is all in the open now open resource things. If you go to the web page there. EHK's Institute of Course where that 102 EGU 102 you can see all of these things. It's not my grandfather's property that I inherited. It's my state property. So you all can see that if you have any questions or anything, I'll be happy. I don't want to take too much time. You guys are eager to get back. All right, my friend, thank you. That's all I have to say. Thank you, Dirk. Dirk, in fairness to you, you had a few things that you wanted to show.
And there's a couple questions up there, so people are interested in seeing some stuff. Do you want to take just a few seconds? And I'm going to hand this to you, because I think for the streaming folks.
Okay, very good. So I mentioned earlier that I had students go out and create their own flash musical animations. So let me show you what students are capable of doing in a group project setting. This is a song many of you would know. It's She Works Hard for the Money by Donna Summer. Students selected the song on their own. I was surprised since it was from 1983, which made me happy. But and they're working in Flash, and they just put a little play button in here. So then the song plays, and you'll get a chance to see how they connected the music to the economics here once the song starts. And then this ends up with a division of labor, since it was a group project to keep everybody accountable. And then after the division of labor, also the work cited. So really just trying to take the idea of a collaborative group project and place it into more of a digital environment where students are learning skills that are transferable, they could put in an e-portfolio or something else. And I started doing this, again, as a way of kind of taking what would otherwise be a pretty detached experience in a big, large lecture room and getting them to work in small groups of students and take some of the larger concepts from the course and then pull them back together in a way that not only I think would be beneficial to them, but it's also beneficial to future generations of economics students who get to see some of these things before my class starts as things now stand. There's one other thing I wanted to show you here, and this is something that is a little bit different. This is a group project where they went out and worked on YouTube. And so I have my own YouTube page, and I've collected some of the best projects that students have worked on. And they had to come up with their own idea. They had to put together the videos and the animations. And then we would basically grade them on two criteria. What was the economic content like was the bulk of the grade. And then around at the margin, you know, how well was this put together? How well was it edited? How well was it thought through? What was the production quality like? And that's where Digital Commons was very, very useful. But the groups themselves came up with some amazing ideas. And so I'll just show you what can be done when you think about this. This is the economics of poker, which I think shows a lot of the interesting elements that are out there.
So Mike, how's it going that economics test?
Aced it, as usual.
Are you serious? I don't even understand it. All you ever do is play poker.
Exactly. Poker is riddled with economic concepts, dude.
Yeah, right. Like what?
Well, I mean, economics is the study of how people make choices, and poker is a game of choices.
Yeah, it's full of decision-making, but I still don't see how that's really directly related to economics.
Well, okay. Well, let's take consumer choices, for example. Consumer choices are always assumed to be made without perfect information.
Yeah.
And in poker, you never have perfect information because you never know the cards your opponent's holding, and you never know how they're going to react to what you do.
Well, right.
So, poker players always choose the highest valued alternative.
Oh, wait. So that's also maximizing constrained choices.
Right. Because you're making decisions solely on the opportunities that present themselves during the hand. In poker, there are public and private goods.
So, the cards are public goods because they're non-excludable and non-rivalrous. Everyone has dealt them every hand. And the pot is excludable and rivalrous, so it would be a private good. Anyone who wants to win it has to pay, and all those people are competing for it.
All right, Zach. Bet is 1,000. Are you willing to call that?
Well, I already have a ton of chips in the pot, so I guess I might as well, right?
No. Whatever chips you already put in the pot, that's a sunk cost. It shouldn't affect your decision now.
Yeah, that's true. But Mike, it's not even gonna matter. Because I was willing to call 1,500. So yes, I do call your cousin. Oh, wait a minute. That's a consumer surplus, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. I bet 1,000, but you were willing to call 1,500. So, the consumer surplus is 500.
Wow. Who knew poker was so similar to microeconomics?
Yeah, who knew? I knew.
Alright, Mike. 5,000. You know what I didn't understand on the test?
What's that?
The prospect theory. Can you help me get that?
Sure.
Oh my gosh.
Well, looks like I just won this monstrous pot. So, how are you going to be playing now?
Well, I guess I'd have to take a lot more risks and try to earn my chips back.
Exactly. And I'd have to play a lot more conservatively because I have a lot more to lose than you. So, the prospect theory says that I'd be a lot more averse to taking risks.
In poker, When deciding on what hands to play, the time and adjustment process evolves. Mike has so many chips that his demand for playing hands is elastic. He can decide over a long run. On the other hand, Zach has so few chips that he is faced with an immediate run decision. He has little time to get his chips back. Consequently, his demand for playing hands is extremely inelastic.
So students come up with these ideas, they work on them, they put everything together on their own. And then again, because it's on YouTube, which is a platform which can be shared, they can watch each other's videos, they can learn from them. You know, that's the whole idea there. And the very best of these are truly inspiring, and they give you hope as a faculty member that something is being learned in the classroom. And so that's the basic idea here. Turn it back over.
Thanks. So a lot of thoughts are going through my head. We've seen things from games that are done in the library that are very traditional. We've seen things like Sarma's doing, which are simulations but have some game-like elements in them. We've seen some things that Dirk is doing that are very engaging. I wouldn't necessarily call them games. But one of the questions I have for you is how much time and effort went into doing all this stuff? Because it seems to me, you know, the simulations and the YouTube videos and all that kind of stuff, there's a heck of a lot of time involved in that. And I just wondered if you'd like to talk briefly on those sorts of things. You know, I know, Bart, you spend a lot of time, I read your blog, you spend a lot of time thinking about it before you even do anything. So could you talk about that for just a little bit?
My time's brief. So I just kind of come up with some harebrained ideas I'd like to try out on freshmen, basically, is how it works with my classes. And then constantly assess, you know, how well they're working, go back, make modifications, things like that. And every year on my own self-assessments, the game-based elements of the class are almost always rated the highest. So I've just continued to try and come up with more and more labs and things like that I can do by myself. I mean, some of these examples are amazing, but you can tell a lot of thought went into this, a lot of support and multiple people working on these things. So that's kind of where I am trying to figure out what can I do solo, pretty much, and roll out quickly and test and kind of build upon. I have a lot of ideas for some of the big interesting things, but right now it's mostly just myself trying some different labs and assignments and then always assessing whether they work or not and then building off that.
I would say that I share the same basic position. That most of this is incremental in nature, that once you find something that works, it's part of your repertoire, and you're going to use it each and every semester. So you try to add one or two things that are new and different, and over time you can develop a really rich course that way. But it wouldn't be something that could happen overnight. Each step in the process requires an investment of time up front in order to get it rolling, and then if you get it rolling the right way, and you could see this up here, that the process will take care of itself to some extent. So, you know, not to get too ambitious to try to do all this at once would be, I guess, the main thing I would add.
Well, let's see. I would say lots of time we spend on the open house, but as an overall thing, it's just one piece of many things that we do, so it's hard to say exactly how much it is. We have a steering group that works with the open house, and then we have people within each one of the subject libraries who are often creating these games and things. So a lot of different people are involved intensively for a short period of time near the beginning of the semester. The planning goes on a longer time, but I think we've seen a real difference in attitude about the library, and we certainly see a lot of students, a lot of people are saying, oh, libraries are dead and it's not happening, and we have, because so much of our material now is digital, though not far from all of it is digital, students don't have to come into the library to use it, but the library is still a very vibrant place and very heavily used, and we think that it has made a big difference. So I think it's a good investment, and games are one part of the many things that we do throughout the open house to try and make it fun and engaging for students. So I'm not sure if that's a good answer or not, but I think that whatever time we put into it has really been worthwhile as sort of first step towards information literacy, which is our overall goal for students to really be very competent information users. But the first step is to sort of get the general idea about scholarly information and sort of a willing attitude towards it.
This is basically an economics question. How much time do we want to spend? You know, how much time do we want to spend? What is the return on investment? I'm sure you buy diapers for your kids. Are you doing economic analysis on it? What the kid is going to do back to you? No, you just do it because you love. Of course, these resources are time consuming. Let me, you know, explain you why I do these things. Our goal was to reach out to more and more students. If I reach out to more and more students, and if we have to teach or if we have to do manually grading all these things and give out different assignments, it's going to take a lot of time. TAs, how many TAs do I need? Each TA is $30,000, tuition, assistantship, and everything. And how many do I need? You know, all these things, if we take into account, I think it is worthwhile spending on these things. 2,500 students, I mean, I sometimes go to my head of the department, you know, always we have to justify our existence, right? So, like Old Main does with the state, and we have to do with everybody. So I tell basically 2,500 students times 3 credits, 7,500 credits at the lowest tuition I'm bringing into the department, whether it comes into the department or not, $3.7 million. So, investing $100,000, $200,000 into this, what are we losing? Students are gaining, students are learning, that's our objective. And if you do the economic analysis, it's beneficial. But you have to find the venture capitalists to get this going, actually. I mean, I was fortunate to get ETS support and e-education support from our own college. Our college is really great in supporting all these things. So I got that capital. But look at the return on it. College is getting a lot of benefits out of it. I'm not trying to undermine this, but if we do a global picture, and how many students are going out with happily rather than if I give, solve 7-6 in the textbook, 8-5 in the textbook, and submit it, they go, geez, this guy doesn't know how to teach. He's reading the slides, or whatever, you know, if we even don't want. So I think overall, the benefit is we cannot measure this. I think, yes, it is time consuming, but it is worthwhile doing it. My answer. My two cents.
Okay, I'm looking over the question tool here, and there is a question that came up, and I guess it has to be asked. This is really to Dirk, for Dirk, the copyright issue using music. I don't think it's showing up there, but it's.
Well, the music that I actually use is played in class, so there's no copyright issue there for me to show a clip from a movie like I would do or show something from YouTube or play a clip with music. That's not a concern. The actual website I went to is a gated website. It's just broadcast to members of the economics education community so that it's not accessible in any sort of public space to protect the copyright users. We're just going to use it as a vehicle to deploy in the classroom.
Yeah, go ahead, Alan.
Probably could show the video to help others here in the room, and then we could talk about that, if that's okay. Do we have the time?
Sure.
Okay. So a couple years ago, I realized that I was doing a series of simulations and activities designed to engage students in class, and thought it would be interesting to film some of these to share with my colleagues who were teaching economics around the country. That's why this YouTube page is here in the first place. And it was mentioned earlier, this is a picture that actually was filmed by a student spontaneously in class when we were doing a demonstration using ACTS to get at the idea of inframarginal externality. So I'll start with this one, and then if we go to the other one, that's fine.
Towards this can on his entire body. He's going all the way.
Yeah. Oh.
Front, back, side, here, and yeah. And he's just,
oh. Oh my god, damn. Can you smell it?
Yeah.
I got it. Let me holler at you.
So this goes on for a minute and 22 seconds, as you can see up there, which isn't a long period of time, but ACTS, of course, and in this case, the scent, actually fills up 100 Thomas. So whether you're in the front or the back of the room, you're like, wow, that's a lot, you know, to smell. And then this poor guy had to go back to his seat, right? So there was somebody who was sitting next to him for the rest of the class. And of course, what I want to point out is that when we think of externalities as economists, that, you know, they can be something that requires public correction, or sometimes it's more of an inconvenience. And so we get at the idea that not everything needs to be corrected through public policy. By thinking about this, you do a memorable demonstration, everybody leaves that day saying, wow, did you see that happen? You know, someone obviously was seeing this happen, thought, I'll actually pull out my cell phone and get this on film, and then they sent it to me. You know, so that tells me that, you know, I'm able to sort of engage and pull the rest of the audience in by doing something simple like this. That was the idea behind that activity. And you mentioned the one with the game theory. This is actually 7 minutes, which is too long. But the idea here, and this is something that I put together, is designed to kind of show how you can use game theory to get people to think strategically about choices they're making. And I invite five students up in front. When I want to invite students up in the class, I usually have an overhead, and I just write down who would like to volunteer today. And, you know, in a room of 700, there's always a few who can't wait to volunteer. So you get five students up there, and they come up, and then they're just surprised by what happens. In this case, they're given a card, which actually describes how it's their, you know, hotness ranking, and they have to act out that role. And so, you know, sometimes they're pretty embarrassed by that. I usually have one of the eights try to ask out one of the tens at the end of it and give them their best pitch line. So you never know what you're going to get in the classroom. But it's really funny to see them think about this. And then from my standpoint, once they've seen their classmates up in front of the room doing something, you can refer to that student by name, and you can refer to their actions, and then you can bring the entire class in and say, well, why did this person do this way? And you can get a really interesting conversation in a really big room, whereas if I had sort of, let's talk about the strategy of dating. Well, you know, I'm 45. They don't want to hear any strategy about dating from me. But if it involves somebody that's young and good-looking in the front of the room and they've gotten on a microphone, then all of a sudden they're really interested in that. So let me see if I can get you to a point here where you guys can watch a little bit of this here. It doesn't look like it's going to load, so we just have to remain a mystery. You can go to the website there and check it out later.
Thanks so much. Okay, a couple other things that have come up here. This is one that has come up over and over during the day, and it really has to do with assessment. How do you assess your students in these activities? Now, Sarma, you've got your assessment built right in. You know going into it that they're going to do certain things. But I'm just wondering, Bart, how you do it, and Dirk, and Loanne, that probably doesn't apply to you quite so much, but it might. So, Bart?
It's not too bad, because most of this is under the guise of, you know, media literacy, digital literacy. I want my kids to learn Photoshop. I want them to learn editing tools for audio and video. So it's basic rubrics is what I usually use. When I get into trying to actually use games to teach, you know, problem solving, teamwork, things along those lines, then assessment becomes pretty hairy. You know, games are kind of assessment. They've built in assessment with scores and levels and things like that. But it's very hard to kind of use games in that context and find out, you know, how far did somebody get? Did you learn anything while you were playing this game? Things along those lines. So I'm still trying to figure that assessment part out. But the idea of using games just to get them hooked with Photoshop and with other hands-on applicable skills, mostly basic rubrics in my class, which work pretty well.
My class is one big game. They have to make $1 million. It's actually based on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. And back when I taught in a smaller classroom, I used to give them 3 lifelines on each exam so they could actually write down the name of a friend who they thought would get the answer right. And if they got it, their friend got it right, they would get that question right. They could poll the class if they wanted to, and they got a 50-50. Now, that's not practical with 700 students, because I think it would take forever to find out if Joe, who actually put down Susie, who put down somebody else, was actually who had the right answer or not. So we don't do that. So they get free 3 free questions on each exam. And then they try to make $1 million throughout the semester. 80% of that would be the examinations. 20% is the projects I've described to you, and there I have a rubric, and you know there they try to earn income along the way. And then as an added incentive to get them to do all the things I want them to do on their own voluntarily, I bribe them with a really small amount of money. But I think college students have no sense of what income means, so they suffer from monetary illusion. So for instance, I could say, This homework assignment is worth $1,000. And, you know, 95% of them will be like, oh, I got to get the $1,000. Well, it's like, you know, 0.1% of their grade, but they're all happy to do it because they think $1,000 is worth a lot. So it's all designed into this idea of, you know, we're gonna work towards this common goal together. And it's meant to be kind of fun and interactive.
We do an assessment at the end of the open house, and it's just a few questions that we have students answer before they register for the big prizes, and we usually have something that's, we usually have lots of great prizes that they really want, and so it's worth answering our 5 little questions or something. We have found that students really like it, that they feel like they've learned about the library, that they will feel more comfortable about coming back and using the library and library resources. And when we usually, the last year or two, we've had more open-ended questions, just what did you like? And that's where we've kind of found out how many students cite the gaming elements, which we hadn't really necessarily focused on along the way specifically so much as just trying to make fun things that would help students learn something about the library or about the particular subject library they were in or the particular service they were at. But we've found so much that the gaming elements are part of what really makes it exciting and fun for them, and the competition, and even something in the life sciences library like a nature trail. So many students think of it as, they'll call it like Gilligan's Island, or they'll make associations with it that make it fun for them. So I think it's gone a long way towards a positive attitude, but it also gives them that big picture of the library and that there are people there to help them, which are 2 of the big things that we're trying to kind of get across. Plus that sort of spatial mapping thing. Having been somewhere, it's not so hard to go there again. And because we have so many floors on so many different areas, if you've never been in anywhere but the front door, it's hard to go explore those areas. So this is a way that they can do it. So I think just getting around to the different libraries around campus and to different locations in Petit and Paterno has made a big impact. But the surveys have been very, very positive. I mean, I think in the last ones, it was 96% or more of the students really felt like it had an educational value to them. So they recognized that it wasn't just just fun and games, that they were really learning something, but they had a good time doing it. And often they said, boy, if I'd known it was going to be so much fun, I would have brought my friends or whatever. But
the assessment of these things, we do it informally and formally also. And the activities, actually, as I said, these are only the means to actually get the subject matter to them. Believe it or not, the students who have taken, these are political science students or art students or golf course management students who are not energy related, but when they are applying their knowledge to their field where they're working, I get emails today. Even today from them, they're not my majors. I don't even remember half of them. But they send me emails saying that what I learned in this course, I'm implementing at my workplace, and this is the dollars that I saved. This is the amount. And students write that, okay, I implemented the things that you have taught me in at home by doing this, 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 and I saved this much money. And this many BTUs of energy, which is environmental benefit. So there are a lot of things indirectly. And directly we assess in terms of how much time, first of all, when they come into these courses, they absolutely hate science. And when they go out, we say, well, how much did you learn, and did it give you any sort of, driving force, to learn more about this? Invariably, a level of 3 in the beginning interest rate, lifelong learning, the commitment has gone up to about 4.5, 5, depending on the semester, but invariably all the students are interested in knowing more about the subject matter after taking the class. That is the success, the way I judge it, But as I said, I don't really assess whether they are understanding the concepts of this, activities or not, but the basic science. And not only that, the way I test whether this is helping or not is to include some questions based on what they have done in these activities into the exam. And seeing whether they are just looking at my, the animations, or whether they are looking really at the subject matter. So, I didn't do any formal assessment so far, but it would be nice to do all this, but there is a lot of data on that.
Okay, this is kind of a double-edged question here. Some of it came from the live question tool, and some of it's a question that I came up with based on previous panels, and it had to do with disruptive technologies and so on. How does administration view what you're doing, and how do your students view it? There's been a couple rounds around where students are still coming in very passive. They're not active. They don't want to engage in their own learning. So administration and students, how are they looking at what you're doing?
Sometimes it could be opposite ends of the spectrum, right? Games are portrayed for violence. If you're looking at video games, violence, obesity is coming up in the news now. Kids aren't out. Kids aren't doing things. So sometimes administrators say, why in the world are you trying to use these in class when, the media is just constantly throwing rocks at this medium? So it's tricky. And then you have students that get engaged. You put up a picture of Halo, Grand Theft Auto, Warcraft, something like that, and 80% of the hands go in the air because they recognize it. They associate with it. Even if they haven't played, they know what it is. They have friends that play, things along those lines. So it's hard to justify sometimes in the administrator's eyes that, look, yes, there are some negative aspects here. There are some bad things about these, but look how much mileage, we're getting in the classroom. Students are more engaged. Students are paying more attention. And you said it, I don't teach the classes to the size that you guys teach, but if you get 700 people engaged in a room using these elements, something right is going on there. Something really powerful is going on there.
I think from the administrative standpoint, as long as you're the steward of the learning environment and you've adopted the best pedagogy or the best approach that you think is going to reach the largest cohort, that you can stand any test from any administrator under any circumstance. So I view the administrator as kind of the check against somebody that's not really doing their job. But for somebody who's passionate and engaged and is attempting to reach students and has a coherent explanation for what they're doing, then I think that falls away. And then you're just back to the idea of reaching students and picking the best possible platform.
It's been a developing process in the library. When we started this, it was, I guess I could say, unpopular. There were lots of questions about what we were doing, how we were doing it, things like, I mean, we're a major research library. I think we're something like the 8th ARL library, and this kind of games and party in the library is not something that had ever happened before or that anybody was accustomed to, and there was a lot of negative reaction at first, both in the administration and among faculty and staff. Over a period of years, though, I think the attitude towards it has changed so much because I think people have seen what it's done for the library, that there's been a change in attitude of the students and how they respond. And so several years ago, I can't remember, the Dean's Library Council actually, you know, sort of took it on and endorsed it and encouraged staff throughout their units to participate in it and to help out with it. And there was a real culture shift in terms of how people within the libraries felt about it. And I think that now there is a really positive attitude throughout the library that it's a really good thing for the library as a whole, that it doesn't demean our status as a rigorous academic library and the types of materials that we offer, but it does help introduce students on a beginning level with the big picture of what the library is. So I think that there's been a huge attitude change within the library administration and within all of those who work within the library. I think faculty all over the university have been pretty positive about sending their students. A lot of students go because it's required for a class and the whole class goes. But over the years, we've also found that more and more students are coming voluntarily just because they've heard about it, they've heard the buzz, they've heard that it's fun, they know what the prizes are and things like that. So I think the last few years, a greater percentage have been coming just on a voluntary basis as opposed to because it was required, but still a lot come who were required. At the very beginning, we had some students, a small handful of students, who were very negative. You know, this is foolish, this is a waste of my time, you know, you're making me do this. We have not seen that in the last few years, hardly at all. People seem to, even that very small percentage, seem to feel like they've done that. And usually we would kind of respond with, well, you know, have you been here? Have you been there? Have you ever seen that? Even students who say, oh, I come to the library all the time, they usually have one place that they always go, but they don't have a clue that there's all this other stuff out there. And so so I would say it's been a huge shift for us from fairly resistant to very supportive, though we still have our ongoing battles with each new thing because we're always pushing the envelope a little bit each year. And the open house team, there's a steering group and a lot of other people who work on various aspects of it. Every year there are new things and we push the envelope in new ways. And I'm using we in the broadest sense because Anne and Emily, who are the co-chairs this year, and Lisa, who's been doing it every year since it started, you know, have really masterminded the whole process, and everybody in the libraries has helped out with it. So,
in my case, administration is very, very supportive. Students are enjoying it. The only problem, let me be frank, is with fellow faculty. They don't know how much time we are spending, and if you are a young faculty member, you cannot afford to spend this much time on it. If you are a faculty member who's tenured or who have your support from the administration that it doesn't matter what you do, you will be able to successfully do it. And let me tell you, the bottom line, as Harvard Review says, people want to associate with success. Because my project has been successful, everybody knew from the day I was born that I was destined to do this. administration, oh, I knew that you were going to be successful. I don't know what, if I had failed, what they would have said. You know, that is the way it is. Students are with me, and in fact, you know, administration is with me. I have seen three deans change in my college recently in the 6 years. Every dean is very supportive. Honestly, very supportive. And students are great. They enjoy. So, yeah. It all depends on what you do. It's up to you to make it successful, and then the administration will support you.
That was our experience, too.
I knew that.
That's excellent. Okay, we have time for one more question. Is there anyone in the audience that has a question that they've maybe perhaps not put on the live question tool but wants to ask? Okay, I got one. What's a good mix for these activities? How much is too much? Where do you find the line between doing these new, more innovative, really active activities versus the maybe more of the traditional stuff?
For me, it's pretty easy because I teach in smaller classrooms. So when my students look at me and say, another game, Bart, are you kidding me? I know it's time to change. I know it's time to move on to some other things. That rarely happens. But that's kind of when I know I need to start looking at some different ways to deliver content, some different ways to get them engaged, things along those lines. That is yet to happen. And one of the things that doesn't really relate to the question, but I know we're closing, so I just wanted to throw this in there anyway. We talked a little bit about, you know, failure and what your administration would think, you know, if something like this were to fail. One thing that games are really good at is this whole idea of, you know, failure states. These things are built on failure states. A lot of times students don't want to do poorly on exams, don't want to do poorly on assignments, things like that. If you can give them this game-based environment and allow them to fail in a safe place repeatedly until they learn things, that's where I'm starting to figure out where a lot of my mileage is coming from. They're able to pick things up quicker, pick things up faster. The games usually give great feedback. You know, when you fail in a game, you know it. Lights go off, sound effects go off, things happen. It's pretty blatant when you're failing at things. But nobody knows but you. It's just you and the computer interacting a lot of times. So the idea of being able to use these failure states as kind of building blocks for learning is becoming a pretty powerful thing in a lot of my courses now.
I have a twofold answer. I teach a 400-level writing course, which has a relatively small number of students in it, and I teach it using what's called behavioral economics or experimental economics. The entire class is a series of activities that are essentially games on every day, and then students have an opportunity to blog on these, and they also have the opportunity to write short papers. It's meant to be a capstone course. It's meant to bring together a lot of elements from their earlier learning in economics. So in one sense, there's no reason why a particular course couldn't be almost exclusively a game. In the bigger class I teach in, I'm very attuned to the fact that these students are going to go on and take intermediate economics and other courses after that. So you have to balance the active learning components of the course along with the traditional components of the course to make absolutely rock solid sure that somebody that walks into the next class doesn't look back and say, well, why didn't we get that in Econ 2? So the core for me is 80% and sort of the games are about 20%.
Well, I've talked mostly about the open house, and that's 2 days out of the year. Even though we plan for it a lot more, it's two long days in the fall semester. So that's one piece of it. We also have done last year, and we'll be doing this year, another gaming day in the library. But it's a pretty small percentage of what we do, and so nobody's complained yet about too much. I think we might have room for a lot more before we get to that point. And also just the idea that we continue to change it every year. We respond to the feedback of the students, what they like. We change the theme, the type of games that happen, and that kind of thing. So some students come back year after year. They really like it.
In my opinion, there has to be a good balance. The way I would use is about 20% is home activities. They're worth 20% of the activity, you know, and there's a lot of instruction going on in class. You know, every class or every alternate class, we do an activity in class, like a puzzle or something that it doesn't count for really any grade, but it counts for class participation. So it is like in a group of people sitting together and learning in a group environment, and part of it is lecture and part of it is the tools. I told you up front, as people want success, administrators want success, students, as long as the students are able to learn and get better grades, they enjoy everything that they do. If they flunk over and over again, the same thing, and if they don't get good grades at the end of the semester, with all these tools, it'll all be down the tubes. Learning is, so we have to balance these things. Ultimately, the knowledge is what is important. These are all only tools, in my opinion.
Can I say one more thing? In terms of the balance, I think I've mentioned a couple of times that we think of this as a very a pre-information literacy skill, and we hope that the students will go on, and most of them do, having experiences actually learning about resources in the library and doing research both at sort of a basic beginning level and again at the disciplinary level within every discipline. And so it's very much sort of a first step, but we try and make it a very positive one so that as they go into more of a research mode, they're feeling more happy and comfortable with it. So.
Okay, before I thank the panel here, I'd just like to mention those of you that have looked along in the wiki and were just dying to play this game that we had created. We didn't get to it. Perhaps next year. There was no way I was going to derail the conversation that was going on here. I thought that was far, far more valuable. So thank you very much, everyone. I think this was truly excellent. Everyone, please give them a round of applause. Okay. And now you're all intrigued. You're going to attend the open house at the library. You're going to go look at Sarma's, and you're going to learn about energy, and you're going to look at Dirk's YouTube stuff. Yes, Sam. Thanks, Jamie. And for those of you who couldn't hear, EGC is starting a podcast series, and the first one that's going to be up there is with Peter Adewu and Eco Racer, which is a game we previously made. And I'm just repeating that really for the cameras more than anything. But okay, we're going to go into our day one wrap up here, where we'll talk about a preview of day two, and Alan's going to, I think, do most of the talking at this point. Is Deb Metzel here? Okay, because Deb was going to make an announcement too, but perhaps she'll do that tomorrow. So.
How many people are going to do? Can you pull up the map? Yes. Off of the wiki, thanks. How many people are planning to do the run, walk, bike, saunter, crawl? Excellent. I have maps of the course for the saunterers. Because my daughter and her friend helped me chalk mark arrows on the route yesterday, and they were really good, but then it rained last night, so I have no idea if there are any directional arrows on the course whatsoever. And since there's construction, those are going to be kind of important. So the maps are up here, so feel free to grab one. Alan's pulling it up right now. What will happen is we'll gather at the corner of College and Allen on the campus side at 5:30. Everybody will go off on the starting line. I will be the official timer. And as you cross the finish line, we will hand you one of these sticks. We're doing this in good old cross-country mode. You'll get a stick with a number on it, and then you'll tell Gentry what your name is, and she'll put your name beside the number. And that way I can tell you what your time was later. That way you'll actually get to know what that is. So if you look at the map up here, we're going to start at College and Allen. You make a right, and you go up Burroughs to Curtin Hall, or to Rec Hall, to Curtin Road, and you make a right. The Creamery is no longer there, but that is still the one-mile point. So that's like kind of that corner that if you made the right, you'd be going down toward Eisenhower. But you continue straight there to the Natatorium. But that's the one-mile marker. at the Natatorium, you go down Bigler Road. Halfway down Bigler, the sidewalk on that side closes. So you'll have to cross over till you get down to Pollock. And Pollock is totally closed, but there's room for pedestrians, okay? And you'll go this way. It's sort of like find your own course, right? I wish there could be beer at the end, because that would be really worth it. At this point, all the arrows are going to be orange if they're still there, right? Once you cross over Pollock, and by the way, Jeff Swain may run into you as he's coming down the finish, because he's really fast. Once you hit Pollock Road, Fraser Road is the road that's in between West Halls and the mall library area. The arrows turn blue at that point. So once you're through the first loop, second loop arrows are blue, if they're still there. And you go up Curtin Road again. You kind of repeat that first course. At that point, you turn right, and you go down past Eisenhower under the bridge of that new science building. You try not to hit anyone who happens to be really sauntering going through the first loop. You come down to College Avenue, and then you finish right in front of St. Paul's. But this is all on the campus side, so just stay on the sidewalks. You can pick up your little stick, and then I'll try to put the times up in the wiki tomorrow.
Awesome. Thank you, Stevie. There is a prize for people who complete. It's the Learn Design Summer Camp pin. What? The time? Oh, don't put the times up.
This is after work hours. So, just want to also add, this is after work hours. So if you get hurt or something like that, we're not paying any disability or anything like that.
Thank you, Cole.
There will be ice at Autos, though.
And I hear beer cures broken bones and that sort of thing too. So, okay, a couple of other things about tonight. There are the Food for Thought dinners. There's the tour of the EGC. Brett, you're still doing that, right?
That's right. Anybody who wants to go on that, just come see me after
we wrap up. Okay, the Food for Thought dinners are two of the sessions are at Mad Max, one's at Otto's, and Brett, are you still doing your one at Gingerbread Man?
Well, since the only people attending are named here on the wiki, I think we'll end up going.
Well, you guys have a great time.
Yeah. Okay. Tomorrow morning, we have our first session at 9 o'clock. It's one of the topics that was one of the top EDUCAUSE challenges, which is learning design in an era of resource constraints and free information. This is about open educational resources, reusing content, using open content, sharing your stuff through Creative Commons, copyright issues, that sort of thing. And then after that, we have a break and then an open forum for 45 minutes. Now, this can really be any questions that weren't asked or weren't answered during the first day. If there are any, if people have really interesting ideas they want to propose, you can do that in the live question tool for that session. You can do that now if you wanted to. And then we'll just try to address whatever issues come up with the most appropriate people, because there is a lot of brain power in this room and a lot of expertise in this room. After that, we'll have lunch, and then I was thinking about maybe playing Sita Sings the Blues, which is related to Creative Commons and that sort of thing. And then after lunch, we have the lightning talks. Last year, we had 10 minutes each, 10 topics. This year, we're doing 5 minutes each. There is a bell that I fear. And I'm going first, I think, somewhere. Yes, collaborative learning spaces. Then we have a quick break, and we'll try to keep this on schedule, and then we should be done sometime around 3 o'clock, and then we can just socialize, catch up with people, we'll tear down the event, and that should be it. So if there are any other questions... Yeah, Brett did put up an evaluation. It's a Google form. You just go in there, and it asks basically what you thought of each of the session, how we can improve it, and whether you'd like to volunteer for organizing next year. If there's nothing else, then we'll see.
Yeah. Chris, do you want to run another round of buzzword bingo tomorrow? Okay. All right. We don't need to do it tomorrow. The only other thing I wanted to mention is down here, and I think Alan mentioned it earlier in the day, it was this learning designer, what the heck am I?
And I'm scrolling here, and geez, there's so many people that came to this thing. This is just kind of, if you can just go into this page, if you have a second, just, you know, who are you, what do you do, how do you work with faculty, that sort of thing. You know, I like Kohl's. What are the things you like to talk about? That's a great way to start a conversation, you know. I was more formal and said, I develop lessons, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, I thought it would be really great to get that kind of thing in there, because the whole concept of learning design, as opposed to just purely instructional design, it's relatively new and it's still a little bit vague and tenuous, and it'd be interesting to see what our definition is of it.
All right, thanks. Could I get a quick picture with anybody who's wearing swag? I think that'd be cool. So you two, Aaron. Well, I'll get a picture with you too. I have another shirt for tomorrow. So that's it. I'll see you at the run, maybe. Have fun.